Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
The Depths, the Evolutionary Origins of the Depression Epidemic, written by Jonathan Rottenberg, narrated by Walter Dixon. Author's note: I don't believe in objectivity, that a man or woman can dispose of his or her biases and have a God's eye view of a topic. All we can do is our best to be honest and truthful about our motivations. For my part, I've been on both sides of depression. I've been a depressed subject, wires trailing out of my head, hospital bracelet on my wrist, poked, prodded, questioned about my symptoms, and I've been the scientific objectifier, the one asking the questions, quantifying the behaviors, noting patterns, tabulating the responses into numbers and graphs, and ultimately into the currency of journal articles. The experiences of both sides are very different, but each is valid. Each represents some truth about this dark, sometimes mysterious topic. Each sheds light on our depression epidemic from different angles. In writing this audiobook, my goal has been to draw both sides together into a complementary synthesis, one that attempts to do justice both to the experiences of patients and to the scientific knowledge we have accumulated in the study of mood and mood disorders. I am grateful for the people who agreed to be interviewed for this audiobook. I have done my best to relate their truth. To protect the identities of interviewees, I have changed names and biographical details throughout. Jonathan Rottenberg, Tampa, Florida. Chapter 1. Why We Need a New Approach to Depression. More than 30 million adults in the United States suffer from depression. Walk down any suburban street in America and start knocking on doors. You'll only need to go to 5 or 6 houses before finding a resident who bears depression's burden. This is not an American story. You could take the same walk in England, Canada, or Italy with the same results. At the University of South Florida, where I teach abnormal psychology to undergraduates, I recently asked my class, "Who among you has been personally affected by serious depression, either in yourselves, in your family, or in a close friend?" 7 in 10 hands went up. It's impossible to deny. The depressed are our neighbors, our teachers, our doctors, our friends. The depressed are always among us. Depression's effects ripple out far beyond the affected individual. For the foreseeable future, depression looms as a preeminent public health menace. In a chilling prediction, the World Health Organization projects that by 2030, the amount of worldwide disability and life lost attributable to depression will be greater than that for any other condition, including cancer, stroke, heart disease, accidents, and war. Perhaps most tragically, suicide, an all-too-common outcome of severe depression, now surpasses automotive accidents as a cause of death, with the suicide rate among Americans ages 35 to 64 increasing by nearly 30% just in the last 10 years. This deteriorating situation seems incongruous, given the resources we have to combat the noonday demon. There is a growing arsenal of psychological and drug treatments for depression. Social awareness about symptoms of depression is increasing, and more people are recognizing that it is a bona fide health condition, not a personal weakness or character flaw. Scientific research on depression, from neuroscience to cross-cultural studies, has absolutely exploded. Yet perversely, as more research and treatment resources have been poured into combating depression, its personal and economic toll has actually grown. Depression now affects more than 15% of the population overall, according to our best epidemiological studies, and is striking people at younger and younger ages. A large nationwide survey, the National Comorbidity Survey Replication, which assessed lifetime depression risk in younger, middle-aged, and older age groups, found that 18 to 29-year-olds are already more likely to have experienced depression than those 60 and older, even though they have been alive for less than half as long. Rampant rates of depression in younger people are worrisome, not only because youth should be a time for blossoming and development, but also because such high rates signal a bleak future for this cohort. Once depression starts, it tends to recur throughout life. Why, despite all the efforts aimed at understanding, treating, and educating the public about this condition, do rates of depression continue to rise? Why have our treatments plateaued in their effectiveness, and why does the stigma associated with this condition remain very much with us? Why are we losing the fight against depression? A broken model. Matt had been a straight-A student in high school back in New Jersey. He was a jokester and beloved by his teachers, who said he was very smart. Now, in his second semester at the University of Pennsylvania, he planned to study environmental engineering. He wanted to travel around the world to work on projects in developing countries. But Matt couldn't concentrate, and he was dead tired all the time. Maybe Penn had made a mistake in admitting him? As he walked around the campus, he saw other students looking down at him. Maybe they were right. He was not as smart, not as rich as them. He was just a chump from New Jersey. He retreated to his dorm room. Yes, he was tired and lonely, but he would just bowl through. He would do what he had to do to get by. Yet as the months rolled by, the feelings of fatigue grew. His concentration shot. Whenever Matt tried to focus on his coursework, his mind would go blank or would drift into thinking about his parents, who had split up 1 year before. The thoughts of bowling through alternated with thoughts of hopelessness and even fleeting thoughts of ending it all. Somehow Matt made it through all his courses, now earning C's. Although he got through the year without academic catastrophe, Matt knew something, and something serious, was wrong. It started to dawn on him. Maybe I'm depressed? From the perspective of formal diagnosis, there was no doubt about Matt's condition. He had multiple symptoms of clinical depression. For months, he had lost interest or pleasure in things he used to enjoy, experienced crushing fatigue, shown an inability to concentrate, experienced dramatic changes in his sleeping habits, and even had periodic thoughts of death and suicide. These symptoms cast a pall over his freshman year and interfered with his ability to engage with his studies or appreciate the novelty of college life. Matt's symptoms and experiences clearly matched the official category of depression, a major depressive episode, as defined by the American Psychiatric Association's Diagnostic Manual. Yet for most sufferers, a diagnostic label of depression merely formalizes what they already know, while raising countless other questions. Depression's symptoms are bewildering and disorienting, even after they are properly labeled. Sufferers want to know about the meaning of the symptoms, what they signify, what they represent, and most of all, why they are happening to them. A diagnosis of depression on its own does not explain the why, offers no interpretation of what might be wrong, and, as important, what needs to change for all to be set right. Faced with a case like Matt's, doctors and therapists today invariably assert that the why of the symptoms resides in a deficiency. That deficiency may be in the person's brain, says the psychiatrist, thoughts, says the cognitive therapist, childhood, psychoanalyst, soul or relationship with God, priest, pastor, or rabbi, or relationship with a significant other, marital or family therapist. These approaches appear different on the surface, but all start from the premise that depression and its symptoms are proof that something fundamental is wrong. Because depression is so unpleasant and so impairing, it may be difficult to imagine that there might be another way of thinking about it. Something this bad must be a disease. Yet the defect model causes problems of its own. Some sufferers avoid getting help because they are leery of being branded as defective. Others get help and come to believe what they are repeatedly told in our system of mental health, that they are deficient. Depression sufferers thus face two trials. The first is the depression itself. Its symptoms, despondency, lethargy, nightly insomnia, and inability to concentrate, are painful and difficult to manage. The second is facing how others respond to the symptoms, hearing the confusing, varied, sometimes hurtful ideas that friends, family, and mental health professionals posit about what is wrong with them. Fearing the reactions of others, many conceal their problems and avoid treatment. The stigma and the impulse to shrink from depression and depressed people are very much alive. As a psychiatrist with an inpatient facility put it, "I work in a hospital with 600 beds that has no gift shop. And it has no gift shop because there isn't the human traffic of people coming to visit people when they're feeling at their worst." People still feel inclined to whisper when they talk about depression. Depression has no race for the cure. This condition rarely spawns dance marathons, car washes, or golf tournaments. Consequently, the lacerating pain of depression remains uncomfortably private. One sufferer remarked on her predicament, "It's, depression is, more malignant than cancer. Well, I have cancer. I have ovarian cancer, and I have severe depression. I'm in 5-year remission now. When I had cancer, and when I was fighting that, I had flowers, I had people at my door, I had people cooking meals for me, I had people at work, you know, rah-rah, here we go. When I'm depressed, isolation. People don't call, they don't know what to say, they don't know how to help, they don't know how to reach out." Nearly every depressed person is presented with the idea that his or her underlying problem is a correctable chemical imbalance. We live in a biological age, and this comforting, optimistic notion is popular, embraced by media, patient groups, and mental health professionals. This mindset is supported by the numbers. 27 million Americans take antidepressants. Yet the results often are disappointing. 2/3 of those treated with antidepressants continue to be burdened with depressive symptoms. Newer antidepressant medications are no more effective than those first developed nearly 60 years ago. The STAR-D treatment trial, one of the largest ever multi-site treatment studies of the effectiveness of drug therapy for serious clinical depression, found that 72% of the 2,876 participants still had significant residual symptoms even after 14 weeks of antidepressant treatment. These residual symptoms are often more than just a nuisance. They include a nagging low mood, difficulty concentrating, continuing insomnia, and the feeling that one's self is worthless. These symptoms are not only debilitating, they are demoralizing. As Matt put it after 2 years of taking Lexapro with only partial improvement, "If the medication can't help me, am I going to be like this forever?" Even those patients who initially respond well to pharmacological treatment are not in the clear. Sadly, their depression will more than likely recur. A major study found that about half of adolescents who recovered from major depression became depressed again within 5 years, regardless of what treatment or therapy they received to get over their initial depression. At the current juncture, even diehard biological psychiatrists acknowledge that the discovery of a physical cause for all cases of depression has proven elusive. We have thousands of biological assays, from brain imaging to blood draws, but still no biological test for depression. Without a clear target of what is being treated, the search for a magic pharmacological bullet for depression verges on the quixotic. A depressed person can also expect to be offered a psychological interpretation of what is wrong with him or her. For example, cognitive approaches see depression as due to faulty thinking, a consequence of distorted ideas such as, "I'm a failure, nobody loves me," or "the future is totally hopeless." This approach has spawned an influential treatment called cognitive behavioral therapy, CBT, a practice intended to correct thought. Like the chemical imbalance theory, psychologically based defect models also exaggerate the case. CBT is about as effective as treatment with antidepressants, beneficial for many, but far from a cure. In fact, it remains murky why CBT works when it does work. Just as aspirin's effectiveness does not prove that headaches are caused by a lack of aspirin, the successes of cognitive therapy don't mean that depression is caused by cognitive defects. Like the search for biological defects, the search for the cognitive defect that causes depression hasn't produced clear answers. Yes, our pharmacologically and psychologically based treatments are better than nothing, but unfortunately, these conventional approaches are far from cures for most sufferers. And ironically, just as the public has become more accepting of seeking treatment for depression, it is not aware of the modest effectiveness of available options. Only recently have there been signs that this is starting to change. A new analysis of 6 major clinical trials in the Journal of the American Medical Association found that common antidepressants worked little better than placebos for people with mild to moderate depression. This report received animated discussion on CNN, in the New York Times, and in other major media outlets. So, why are we losing the fight against depression? I have come to the belief that the intuitively appealing idea that depression stems from defects has led us directly to our current impasse. If you go to a conference in clinical psychology or psychiatry, I can promise you, you will experience 2 things. 1, you will hear many fascinating presentations on the cognitive, social, biological, and developmental aspects of depression. 2, you will be unlikely to hear much about the depression epidemic. This seems odd until you realize that none of the major research paradigms equips us to understand why we are beset by a depression epidemic. If depression results from faulty cognitions, why would our cognition suddenly become so faulty? If it's faulty biology at work, why would our equipment fail us now and on a mass scale? Our genetic endowment, for example, does not turn on a dime. Even if one looks to the environment, which is always changing, it's not immediately obvious what aspect of it has changed so drastically as to account for such a surge in depression. In challenging the depression as defect view, it is reasonable to wonder about the alternatives. Some commentators and scholars have gone to the other extreme, arguing that depression is beneficial. From improved problem solving to resource conservation, several accounts put the focus on depression's overlooked benefits. So if we reject the disease model, it seems we must adopt the position that depression is good. Or must we? One sufferer implicitly rejected this overly simplistic choice, saying about her depression, "It sucks, but there's value in it." In the chapters to come, I hope to show that taking this more nuanced position allows us to ask more interesting questions about depression. Depression is potentially good and bad, a point of departure that may help us get closer to the mystery of what depression is, why so many suffer from it, and why it is such a tough nut to crack. The mood science approach. At the center of the nut is mood. Depression's defining feature is a persistent low mood. The typical depressed person reports moods that are excessively dull, empty, and sad, as well as moods that lack joy, excitement, or cheer. The centrality of mood to depression is reflected in its classification as a mood disorder. Yet modern approaches to depression, be they biological, cognitive, or social, have focused on just about everything but mood. In part, this is because the study of mood had little momentum for most of the 20th century. Researchers had little interest in the topic. Skeptics questioned whether something as evanescent as mood could ever be studied with precision or objectivity. Just as CAT scans and functional magnetic imaging allowed physicians to see the innermost recesses of the body, so too, in the last 30 years, an increasingly sophisticated set of tools has enabled us to measure mood and emotion. The emerging field, known as affective science, now benefits from an enviable wealth of measurement tools, with standard techniques for measuring both moods that people report, systems for measuring behavior in the lab and in the field, and new ways to monitor the physiology of mood and emotion, from functional brain scans to miniature sensors that monitor the body as people go about their everyday lives. Amid these exciting developments in the mid-1990s, I arrived at Stanford University as a new graduate student in psychology, full of hope and naivete. There I saw other scientists beginning to apply the methods and insights from affective science to the study of psychopathology. Anne Kring at Berkeley, one of my idols in the field, was using these techniques to discern how schizophrenia altered feelings and emotional behaviors, observations that cast the disorder in an entirely new light. As I watched Anne give a presentation on her work at Stanford, I thought, we need to do this for depression. I am no longer that bright-eyed student, but in the years since those California days, it has become increasingly clear to me that affective science holds the key to understanding and treating depression. And as the depression epidemic has accelerated, getting at its root causes has become a matter of some urgency. This audiobook is, above all, an attempt to elucidate the relationship between mood and depression. Our model is broken. We need to usher in a new diagnostic and therapeutic paradigm, one based in the science of mood. To appreciate what affective science can tell us about mood disorders, we first need to understand what moods are. Why do we have them at all? Here, we explore the architecture of the mood system, an ancient system that influences what we feel, think, and do, as well as guiding our bodily responses to the world. All organisms, from planaria to sidewinders to rock stars, face the great problem of behavior. What, given a limitless menu of possibilities, should a creature do? A billy goat by the farmhouse can eat a tin can, take a nap, chase chickens, or run in circles. How does it decide what to do first? Fortunately, the goat, like all animals on the farm, has a head start on this problem because it has been equipped with a behavioral guidance system that moves it toward actions that have been successful in the past, which is to say, actions that led ancestor goats to successfully reproduce and spread their genes. In other words, moods are internal signals that motivate behavior and move it in the right direction. To understand the formidable role that moods play in our survival, remember Charles Darwin's theory of evolution and his profound idea that evolutionary pressures shaped not only physical features, but animals' mental processes and behavioral characteristics as well. As a first step, the mood system needs to know what kind of situation it is in. Different situations have different implications for fitness, that is, survival and reproduction. For our goat, the situation includes the external world of the barnyard. Is it dark or high noon? Hot or cold? Is food nearby and plentiful, or far away and scarce? Might there be predators about? The situation also includes the goat's internal world. Is it bleeding, sick, or in pain, hungry, or satiated? All of these elements affect mood. The mood system, then, is the great integrator. It takes in information about the external and internal worlds and summarizes what is favorable or unfavorable in terms of accomplishing key goals related to survival and reproduction. These computations are automatic. The goat is unaware it is doing evolution's bidding when it eats a carrot. Eating a carrot feels good for a reason. Animals feel pleasure when they pursue actions that lead to survival and reproduction. Moods sculpt behaviors in ways that enhance fitness and do so without the animal's express permission or knowledge. Yet moods are more than a summary readout of the status quo. They set the stage for specific emotional behaviors. Most of us have experienced a situation in which an irritable mood made it easier for a minor slight to trigger an outburst of rage, or when an anxious mood made us so jumpy that just a few strange noises in the night provoked full panic and terror. Confirming scientists' intuitions, controlled experiments find that an anxious mood narrows the focus of attention to threats. When anxious subjects are shown happy, neutral, and angry faces on a computer screen, their attention is drawn to the angry faces, signaling a potential threat. Conversely, good moods broaden attention and make people inclined to seek out information and novelty. In one study, participants in good moods sought more variety when choosing among packaged foods, such as crackers, soup, and snacks. Moods have the power to influence behavior because they have such wide purchase on the body and mind. They affect what we notice, our levels of alertness and energy, and what goals we choose. Finally, once a goal is embarked upon, the mood system monitors progress toward its attainment. It will redouble effort when minor obstacles arise. If progress stops entirely because of an insuperable obstacle, the mood system puts the brakes on effort. Experiments have successfully tested the idea that negative mood mobilizes effort when tasks become challenging. When participants are put in a negative mood and subsequently are given a difficult task to perform, they can be expected to show a larger spike in blood pressure, a key index of bodily mobilization. Yet, if the task is made significantly more difficult, to the point that success is no longer possible, participants no longer demonstrate the sharp spike, a sign that the mood system de-escalates effort for impossible or seemingly impossible tasks. The switch makes sense. Given that nearly all key resources are finite, be they time, energy, or money, expending them on unreachable goals can be ruinous. This is particularly evident in goals related to physical survival, such as food seeking. When a bear catches no salmon after hours of working a favorite bend in the river, the mood system decides that it's time to pull back and move on. The same principle also applies to longer-term commitments. Take the goal of bearing a child, a deeply held commitment for many women. We could expect that, for a woman who has such a goal and has not yet fulfilled it, menopause would be accompanied by a period of low mood that would eventually diminish after she gives up on this now unreachable goal and adjusts to reality. We would also expect that a woman who continued to want to bear a child despite its impossibility would experience a further escalation of low mood. Research supports these predictions exactly. Mood flexibility tunes behavior to situational requirements, which is why it makes it so effective as an adaptation. When a situation is favorable, high moods lead to more efficient pursuit of rewards. Reward-seeking behavior is invigorated. Eat grass while the sun shines. In an unfavorable situation, low moods focus attention on threats and obstacles, and behavior is pulled back, hunker down until the blizzard ends. Mood reflects the availability of key resources in the environment, both external, food, allies, potential mates, and internal, fatigue, hormone levels, adequacy of hydration, and ensures that an animal does not waste precious time and energy on fruitless or even dangerous efforts, doing a mating dance when predators are lurking. More than words. One of the amazing things about the mood system is how much of it operates outside of conscious awareness. Moods, like most adaptations, developed in species that had neither language nor culture. Yet words are the first things that come to mind when most people think about moods. We are mad, we are sad, we are glad. So infatuated are we with language that both lay people and scientists find it tempting to equate the language we use to describe mood with mood itself. This is a big mistake. We need to shed this language-centric view of mood, even if it threatens our pride to accept that we share a fundamental element of our mental toolkit with rabbits and roadrunners. Holding to a myth of human uniqueness puts us in an untenable position. For one thing, it would mean that we deny mood to those humans who have not yet acquired mood language, babies, or have lost mood language, Alzheimer's patients. Toddlers, goats, and chimps all lack the words to describe the internal signals that track their efforts to find a mate, food, or a new ally. Their moods can shape behavior without being named. Language is not required for moods. All that is needed is some capability for wakeful alertness and conscious perception, including the perception of pain and pleasure, which is certainly present in all mammals. Further, relying solely on language provides a misleading picture of what moods really are all about. Although a sad mood involves states we might label as down or depressed, moods encompass the full body and mind, from drooped posture and downcast glances to changes in immune and hormonal systems and darkened perception and memory. We notice every slight, every fault, and are flooded with memories of past failure. It is telling that severely depressed humans find verbal labels like sad or down pitifully inadequate to describe their inner sensations and experiences. What we say about our feelings is only one window on mood. Because mood leaves more than one kind of fingerprint, we need to be open to a variety of evidence in the mind, in the brain, and in behavior to appreciate moods in action. Mesmerized by our linguistic abilities, it is understandable that humans feel compelled to tell ourselves stories about our moods. Moods, especially intense moods, by their nature, grab attention and call for explanation. Next time you are in a brooding, seething stew of an irritable mood, see if you can resist the urge to explain why. Yet, despite this impulse, the stories we tell ourselves about our moods are fraught with error. We hypothesize that we feel down because we have gotten behind at work. The true reason for the feeling may be that we are getting over a cold and our bodies are depleted of strength. At other times, try as we might, we cannot generate any story for our mood. I don't know why, I just feel low. We are forlorn and baffled. At a loss, we might turn to a therapist to help us revise our story. Of course, making sense of our feelings is not always a hopeless task. If a driver cuts us off in traffic, we know full well why we are suddenly bawling our fists and yelling. This burst of anger is the hallmark of an emotion, defined as a short-term reaction to a specific event. So too with other emotions. If we have a sudden burst of fear or of embarrassment, we usually have a story at the ready. The big hairy spider, the glass of red wine that is spilled on our lap. Moods are different. Moods take longer to come on and to go away. They are an overall summary of the various cues around us, and usually they are harder to sort out. Because humans operate in complex environments that contain a confusing buzz of ever-changing objects, getting a fix on our moods is more challenging than it seems. Our heavy reliance on symbolic representation also makes the precipitance of low mood more idiosyncratic in our species than in others. We become sad because Bambi's mother dies, because there are starving people a continent away, because of a factory closing, because of a World Series defeat in extra innings. Though there is a core theme of loss that cuts across species, humans' capacity for language enables a larger number of objects to enter and alter the mood system. Despite our deep yearning to explicate moods, the average person cannot see many of the most important influences on mood. As the great interrogator, the mood system is acted on by many potential objects, and many of the forces that act on mood are hidden from conscious awareness, such as stress hormones or the state of our immune system. Left to our own devices, the stories we tell ourselves about our moods often end up being just that, stories. That's where mood science comes in. Fortunately, a systematic, research-based mood science approach has begun to replace folk wisdom, or folk ignorance about mood, with hard data. Although our ability to predict mood in a specific person is not yet as accurate as tomorrow's weather prediction, a growing body of work is starting to reveal the many factors that influence mood, from inborn temperaments to transient events to daily routines. One of the main strengths of mood science, particularly useful for the purpose of this audiobook, is that the same factors can be used to explain both typical mood variation and extreme moods like severe depression. The mood science approach, thus, has a unique potential for explaining why we are in the middle of a depression epidemic. We must understand the ultimate sources of depression if we are to ever get it under control. To do so, we need to step back and replace the defunct defect model with a completely different approach. The mood science approach will be both historical and integrative. Historical, because we cannot understand why depressed mood is so prevalent until we understand why we have the capacity for low mood in the first place. And integrative, because a host of different forces, many hidden, simultaneously act on people to impel them to the kinds of low moods that breed serious depression. Further, we will also integrate how people respond to periods of low mood, including responses that, even with the best of intentions, often have the paradoxical effect of making depression worse. Stepping back means that the depths has an immodestly large scope, spanning the ultimate origins of the capacity for depression to the forces that impel people in and draw people out of depressive episodes. Although it might be comforting to blame someone or something, no single villain or cause can explain the entire depression epidemic, nor is there a single factor that, if changed, would reverse the epidemic. Instead of proposing yet another single bullet theory of depression, the chapters ahead detail a remarkable confluence of unfortunate circumstances. Some began many millions of years ago and are built into the architecture of our mood systems, whereas others, like human language, are of more recent advent, and still others reflect cultural and social factors operating in the last 20 or 30 years. By examining these circumstances, we can begin to understand how together they have created the perfect storm of mood. Only then will we get to the bottom of the depths of depression, and in so doing, discover new ways to climb back out.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.